everybody. I'm Jill Berry. I'm the new executive director at Morven across the street. Hopefully you have been there. If you have not, this program is in conjunction with our Bruce Springsteen exhibition. The exhibition is open until May 21st, so I encourage you to join us over there and see the beautiful images from the photographers. It's really quite special. There's only a few performance photographs, so they're very intimate photographs of Bruce that you get a sense of who he is as a person throughout his years. There are early and late photographs, so that's really quite wonderful. We're delighted to be partnering with the Center for Theological Inquiry and the library. I understand a number of you are here through the library program, so welcome. And without further ado, I turn over to Barb Webb, our special events coordinator.
Welcome, everyone. And thank you, CTI, Center of Theological Inquiry, and Will Storrar, who is the director, for hosting us and partnering with us. I'm going to introduce our two gentlemen here. I'm going to start with Will. My friend Will Storrar has asked me to keep his introduction very short. However, he does want you to know two things. One, he is Scottish, and two, he's the proud director of the Center of Theological Inquiry, an ecumenical institute for interdisciplinary research in the field of religion. The common thread of the center's work is the practice of collaboration in the academy, church, and civil society. To quote Will, we do one thing and only one thing at CTI. We gather the best scholars from any discipline in any part of the world to think together on a common big question of our time. And we do that not through big conferences and large research projects, but by small-scale conversations around the table. As a former CTI scholar put it, quote, CTI is a place where currents from all over the world, across the spectrum of theological, sociological, and cultural inquiry, flow together, ferment, and flow out into the areas which may not have been anticipated by the center's founders back in 1978. Our special guest this evening is Professor Azzan Yadin-Israel. Azzan has a BA from the Hebrew University and a PhD from the University of California, Berkeley. I'm going to read to you a very short feature from the publication Rutgers Today about Azzan's latest book. He's a self-proclaimed agnostic, but Bruce Springsteen sure has his share of disciples. There are members of his flock who follow every tour, know every bit of trivia, and can sing every song in their sleep. To them, Springsteen's practically a deity, and their devotion to him is unwavering. So maybe it shouldn't come as a surprise that the boss often gets biblical in his songs. That's what Azzan Yadin-Israel discovered when he delved into the revered New Jersey Rockers catalog of lyrics for his new book, The Grace of God and the Grace of Man, the Theologies of Bruce Springsteen, published in August by the Lingua Press. Yadin-Israel spent 2 years mining Springsteen songs for his book, unearthing numerous Old Testament themes and reinterpretations of Bible passages from his lyrics. A professor in the Department of Jewish Studies and Classics at Rutgers, Yadin-Israel usually teaches courses in early rabbinic literature, the Dead Sea Scrolls, Jewish mysticism, and Plato. But in 2013, after he picked up on the religious motifs in the singer's earlier work, he offered a seminar on the subject, titled none other than Bruce Springsteen's Theology. On behalf of everyone at Morven and our partners with the Princeton Public Library, I offer our heartfelt thanks to Will and his wonderful staff at CTI for hosting us tonight, and to Azzan for sharing his insights on the case of Bruce Springsteen. And we thank you all for being with us.
May I add my own personal word of welcome to Luce Hall. We are seated under the gaze of Henry Luce, the founder of Time magazine, the magazine that brought Bruce Springsteen into prominence early in his career. So it's very fitting that we're sitting under the gaze of Henry. But we're here in the company of Azzan, and as Barb has very kindly said, I come from Scotland. So my first question, perhaps my only question this evening to you, Azzan, is what is a good Jewish boy from Cleveland doing talking about a good Catholic boy from New Jersey to a Scottish Presbyterian? And I suppose the answer is that what binds us all together is theology. Talk about not only in a formal sense God, but the ultimate and big concerns that every human being shares at some time in our lives, both in the heights and in the depths. I hope I won't be thrown out of the building immediately to say my knowledge of Springsteen's music is recent. It came after an invitation to host this conversation. But I truly want to thank Barb and you for introducing me to someone I was familiar with because of Lorini's garage here in Princeton, sadly no longer, where the owner, Mr. Lorini, was devoted to Bruce and erected a magnificent statue to him on Alexander Street. So I had a sense of how deep in the hearts of the people of New Jersey this singer is. But what led you to, we've heard formally what led you to write this book, but what resonated in your life that made you interested not only in the singer, this great cultural icon, but in the poet and the writer of these extraordinary songs?
All right. Well, before I answer, I just have to thank everyone. I want to thank Barb, and I want to thank you, and I want to thank the library, and just everyone's been wonderful and welcoming, and I'm very grateful and excited to be here. In terms of the question, what drew me to this? Well, I mean, my training is in ancient texts. In other words, my PhD deals with early rabbinic interpretation of scripture, and I also work on ancient Greek philosophy. So it's all been, you know, very much in the ancient world, Hebrew, Aramaic, Greek texts, and the like. However, at the same time, I've also had an ongoing curiosity about the way in which ancient texts, particularly canonical texts, usually religious texts, are reinterpreted and re-illuminated in particularly modern contexts, sometimes non-religious or not traditionally religious contexts. This may be because I grew up in Israel and that tension between the ancient and the modern is very much present in Israeli culture. The Hebrew language itself is both ancient and modern in some sense. So, I mean, biographically, there are probably things that resonate there, but the basic idea is that religious texts don't belong and historically haven't been limited to theological libraries or churches or synagogues, but they have entered into the broader language of poets and writers and thinkers. And when I started to recognize these elements in Springsteen, I just got very curious and very excited about that and pursued it in the way that I have.
We're here this evening to talk about Azzan's book, The Grace of God and the Grace of Man, The Theologies of Bruce Springsteen. Let's begin by you telling us about the book itself. What does it cover?
Well, I mean, it covers everything that I thought could go in there in terms of Springsteen's lyrics. The book is, first of all, not about Springsteen the man. In other words, it's not about his own religious beliefs or lack of beliefs or anything like that. I don't know that matter. I have no access to him as an individual. So, you know, that's just something that it's helpful to put that out in an explicit way. It's about his work. It's about him as a writer, him as a poet. And that's the way I studied his lyrics, reading in the same way as you would read the lyrics of a poet, you know, very carefully, or as carefully as one can. So the book is divided into three parts. The first part traces his early writings, which are fairly unified thematically. In other words, in Springsteen's early writings, you can see two main motifs. One is a fairly harsh critique of traditional religious institutions, particularly Catholic institutions, alongside a kind of, maybe gospel is an overstatement, but the promise of a certain kind of redemption in this world. You know, a this worldly redemption that is usually associated with a car, and a knight, and a woman, and those things together are, you know, they're not the same kind of, you know, religious redemption, but it's what we really can have, and it's a real thing. All of that culminates in Born to Run, and quite amazingly, I have to say, considering that Born to Run really made him into a star the way it did, the very next album, Darkness on the Edge of Town, completely undermines that. He basically steps back and in a very reflective way says, you know those elements I talked about? I was wrong. You know, I was wrong about that. These aren't paths to redemption. It's a very dark album. I mean, the darkness is in the title also. But it's darkness that's on the edge of town because the person never leaves. As far as he gets is the edge of town. Because there's really nothing, there's nothing beyond it. There's no, the highway's just a road in a certain way, and it's not leading you to anything. It's a very, I mean, we'll talk about this in greater detail in the course of our conversation. So that's the first part, is that kind of trajectory. The second part, after Darkness on the Edge of Town, I couldn't find a chronological narrative, you know, with which to structure the book. So it switches to thematic. I examined three themes that Springsteen deals with in later works or post-darkness works. And those are sin and the way that he interprets sin, redemption, and the struggle within. So those are the three chapters in the second part, which is to say, obviously, sin is not what you go to church and confess. It's not. But what does sin mean to Springsteen? How does he interpret that? And he uses that language. You know, he uses the language, traditional language of sin, traditional language of redemption, and the moment where there's a struggle within the individual who is being kind of pulled in two ways. On the one hand, maybe towards sin, which is to say, in Springsteen's terms, giving in to your fears or your hatred, or whatever dark things are tugging at us. And on the other hand, redemption, which is a kind of grace that you get from being the best self that you can be, from us being our best possible selves. And that moment, he has quite a few songs where he charts that struggle within the individual. The third part of the book, the third section, is called Springsteen's Midrash. So Midrash is a Hebrew term for rabbinic biblical interpretation. It's my day job, basically, to work on Midrashic texts. But, and the idea there is to look at songs that are explicitly biblical. In other words, where songs like Adam Raised the Cain, or Jesus Was an Only Son, and then see what is Springsteen doing when he takes a song and says, this is a song about a biblical text, how is he rereading and reinterpreting the biblical text? And the idea here is that there's a twofold movement. On the one hand, the biblical text, and it's Hebrew Bible and New Testament, in different songs, the biblical text obviously illuminates the song because knowing the context of the reference is going to be critical to understanding the song. But at the same time, there's a way in which the song illuminates the biblical text. In other words, that it's not simply trying to understand Springsteen's song by saying, look, here's what he's talking about on the biblical side. It's also then saying, now that we understand what he said, does that change our understanding of that biblical text? In other words, as an interpreter, and to me, it was really, I have to admit, quite surprising the extent to which that held true. In other words, that many times I would be taken aback by how interesting and insightful and subtle these readings were. And you know, and again, I hope we will get a chance to maybe show this in a little bit of detail through one of the Psalms.
Well, let's come back later to these three parts of the book and the narrative arc of his lyrics that you take us through, and we're going to listen to excerpts at least from some of these songs. But I want to start, Azzan, with you as a scholar and how you have approached the theologies of Bruce Springsteen. And you first make an argument that theology, as you've already mentioned, is not found in places like Jewish Theological Seminary in New York, Princeton Theological Seminary even, this center. It's also found, in a sense, promiscuously out there in the world, where religious ideas get picked up on in everyday language, in one particular area that you're looking at, the imagination of the artist. But in your introduction, you very deliberately distinguish your approach from that of other scholars. There are many scholars who write about religion and culture, religion and music, and popular music, and iconic musicians like Bob Dylan or Leonard Cohen. And their approach is really to ask, in a sense, how religious are they, personally?
Right.
So we know the stories, you know, Dylan in his Christian phase, back to a Jewish phase, and so on. Leonard Cohen very movingly, towards the end of his life, going back to his home synagogue, and the cantor, and the choir. But you're taking a different approach. Describe that to us.
Well, I am pretty adamant in my book about separating biography from theology, or from just the analysis of the work of the artist more broadly. First of all, with Springsteen, that's a constant draw because people are so, you know, many people feel like a personal connection, and they obviously, the book came out before his autobiography, but since the autobiography's come out, that's even been more prominent, you know, his life and his work. The problem that I find with that kind of analysis is twofold. First of all, for me personally, I have nothing to bring to that conversation. I don't, you know, I'm not a friend of Springsteen's. I'm also not a reporter for Us Weekly, or, you know, I don't know, whatever area of the world, you know, deals with that kind of stuff, that's nothing that I can contribute to. But the deeper issue is that I think it obscures, when we phrase these things, when we think of them and conceptualize them in personal terms, we lose sight of the way in which, in this example, Springsteen is making artistic choices. So let me just explain what I mean by that. So Springsteen grew up, he's Catholic, he went to Catholic school. Okay, so people say, all right, so there are Catholic elements there, right, he went to Catholic school. Well, yes and no, because you know what? Sting went to Catholic school.
Right.
Elvis Costello went to Catholic school. I mean, there's a list. Celine Dion, Paul McCartney. I mean, you have all of these, and they don't write about these things. So it is true that understanding his biography maybe shows where he's drawing from. You know, I mean, it gives you a sense of his sources as an artist. But it doesn't explain the artistry, because all of these other people, singers, songwriters, who have, you know, tremendous songbooks, they might have less references to theological and biblical elements than in two of Springsteen's songs. So that same thing with being a blue-collar worker. You know, he has a lot of songs about working-class people. I mean, most of the songs that, you know, deal with. So yes, he grew up in that way, but you know, Iggy Pop grew up in a tiny little trailer in Ypsilanti, Michigan. And he doesn't write in that way. So, you know, I want to kind of insist on the fact that these are artistic choices that of course draw on his own past. I'm not saying that they represent some kind of break with who the person is, but that if we only think of them in biographical terms, we're losing the force of the artistry.
Yes. So you take a different approach, which is to say, and I'm quoting you now.
Oh, now I'm in trouble. What did I say?
Certain points, you mentioned Milosh and my wife's favorite poet, Grace Perry.
Yes, yes.
They employ traditional religious terminology in new ways, albeit to a different effect. So you're, that's what you're interested in.
I am interested in that. I find that a particularly interesting intersection between the ancient and the modern. Mm. So, which is to say, so Czesław Miłosz and Grace Paley are just two of the poets that I could have chosen other poets. You know, there are many other poets, but I analyze in the opening of the book two poems in which each of these poets uses the language of either kind of Christian mysticism in Miłosz or the Hebrew Bible in the Book of Psalms in Grace Paley's work, and they, to some extent, reverse, in other words, they turn them into secular songs in a way. Now, it's a little tricky to say secular, because whenever you have that moment, there's a sense in which I'm saying this kind of in very crude terms, you're bringing down the sacred into our world. There's also a sense in which you're elevating our world into the sacred. You know, and there's a tension there, you know, which is being done. Is it, are they elevating our world, or are they kind of debasing the sacred? Not a tension that I think can be resolved, but yeah.
But you're saying, in one way, you're putting Bruce Springsteen in the company of these poets and saying, he too is drawing on the ancient religious imagery.
Yeah.
You're not concerned to try and map that onto his autobiography, his biography.
Right, right.
You're looking at this as the work of an artist.
Yeah.
And the text has its own life beyond what Springsteen meant by it.
Yeah.
That you, as a scholar of text, can read and interpret and handle in a similar way.
All I can say is it surprised me as much as anyone. In other words, I was invited by Rutgers to teach a seminar for incoming freshmen. You know, so the areas that I work in, early rabbinic literature, Plato, not, you know, beating down the doors to get into the classes.
Well, Plato is big in New Brunswick.
He's got a closet. I don't know if it's related, but so I thought, you know, I'll do something. I had actually written a piece on an Israeli hip hop band called the Dag Nachash, analyzing their Hebrew lyrics in a similar way. It was a very short piece, and I thought maybe I could do something like that with an English, an artist writing in English, an American musician, most likely. You know, and I started looking at the songbook, and initially I felt like I had enough to just teach a 10-week seminar for freshmen. It's a very basic kind of introduction. It's not something, I had to do it as a seminar because in my departments, I can't offer anything like that. I can't do it in Jewish studies because Springsteen isn't Jewish. And I can't do it in classics because they absolutely refuse to include classic rock. You know, I made the argument, but I fell on deaf ears. So as I was reading this again, and this was now, you know, I had already prepared the class, but I was going over it again and again and again with the students, I started to realize that I was not doing justice to the text. So, you know, it's the proof of the pudding is in the eating. You know, if the song gives of itself in that way and can be read as a piece of poetry, then it is. You know, whether it was written by a Nobel Prize laureate like Czesław Miłosz or by, you know, a rock and roll icon, that's just what I discovered, you know. So I never set out, you know, I mean, this is a huge departure for me. I never set out to be like, you know, I'm gonna make Springsteen into this guy. It wasn't something that I even realized where it would end up. In the course of the writing and the study, that's what manifested itself.
You bring up beautifully in the book how Springsteen himself sees his own creative process.
Right.
That you describe as an intuitive artist, and he would describe himself
Yeah, that's how he describes himself, right. Yeah, I mean, that's another issue with the kind of model of mapping his biography onto his work and so forth. Springsteen has spoken about his own writing process, and he says, you know, there's a episode in the VH1 series Storytellers that's dedicated to Springsteen, and he analyzes one of his own songs, Devils and Dust. And he says to the audience, you know, how much of what I just said is in the song? All of it. How much of what I just said did I realize when I wrote it? None of it. So, I mean, at least as he presents himself, you know, he's working on this song, and he's obviously he's using the language in a coherent way. It's not a trance or anything like that. But he's not analyzing it. He's not then saying, oh, you know, what motifs am I drawing on? What? But rather, as he represents it, it's kind of welling up from within him. And one of the things that I think I was really astounded is how creative he is. For Darkness on the Edge of Town, for example, they have 60 songs that were recorded in the studio that never made it onto the album. The album, I think, has 11 songs. So, I mean, there are notebooks upon notebooks. He's walking around, every photo you see of him in the 70s, he's got this huge notebook, you know, and he's just lyrics, 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 music, music, music. So it's flowing, and that is, to some extent, that means that the artist is not necessarily the best interpreter of his own work. You know, he's creating, and it's possible that a few years later, or depending on the song, a few decades later, someone else will come along and say, well, all right, now you wrote that, let's step back and kind of analyze it more analytically, more poetically, and see what emerges.
And you've done that by interpreting these songs theologically, looking at the religious imagery, both Jewish from the Hebrew Bible and Christian from the New Testament.
Right.
May I say at this point, a very personal word, the center was founded to be a place where scholars of different religious traditions, Jewish, Christian, Muslim, Buddhist, Hindu, and so on, could be in residence and work alongside one another in order to find a deeper understanding of one another's traditions from each other. And as a theologian working in the Christian tradition myself, I want to say how beautifully, sensitively, and accurately you interpret Christian texts in relation to Springsteen's work. I think that's an extraordinary interreligious scholarly achievement that is evident throughout this book. But let's think then about how you are interpreting his text, which you feel has an academic and artistic integrity to do, because that's what any work of art has the capacity to do, beyond the imagination and the intention of the artist, whether a singer, a poet, or a playwright, or a novelist. Yeah. So you see these striking theological themes in, and as you say, you don't try and cover every song, every religious reference. It's not a dictionary of Springsteen and religion.
Right.
You've used your own scholarly judgment, and may I say your own narrative writing skill, to draw out three acts in the theological drama of Springsteen's lyrics.
Right.
And the first one, let's start not with more of words from us, but with the song you've chosen.
Okay.
To take us into this first early period in his music where you see a particular set of theological motifs.
Wonderful. Well, I'm going to just...
As we fire up the engine...
As we fire up our computer...
You will find on your seat the words. And this song is...
So this is going to be Thunder Road,
which is the second song on the sheet.
And as I'm pulling this up, I'm going to, a lot of people don't need the lyrics, I know that.
Sing along, as we say.
So it's a fairly long song, and we don't want to you know, just take too much time. So we're going to hear the first couple of stanzas, and then I'll try and kind of demonstrate the analysis that I'm putting forward in this particular context. Okay, so this is the end or the culmination of Springsteen's early work. In other words, the two motifs of, on the one hand, critique of traditional religion, and on the other hand, the promise of a kind of this-worldly imminent salvation.
What I want to suggest
and how I interpret the song, and most of the material is in the part we just heard, just a little reference to what we had to cut out for time's sake, is that this song is basically a dialogue of sorts between two religious sensibilities. In other words, this is the moment where the two themes that I mentioned, in other words, the critique of traditional religious practices and institutions, and the promise of this worldly redemption, where they meet. How so? Each of these figures represents one of these approaches. So Mary is associated with otherworldly redemption. She's like a vision. She's a little bit incorporeal, like a vision, you know, doesn't have physical reality. She's not fully embodied in some sense. She's dancing across here like a vision. He says to her, let me first do her image and then turn to his. She's very concerned with imperfection. In other words, with her own humanity in some sense. You're scared, you're thinking that maybe we ain't that young anymore. You know, it's not perfect, and she's concerned about that. But the most telling part is in this beginning of the second stanza, where he says, you can hide with your covers and study your pain, make crosses from your lovers, throw roses in the rain, waste your summers praying in vain for a savior to rise from these streets. So this language is a language of a kind of traditional Catholic practice. In other words, which he does not condone. In other words, he is trying to draw her away from that practice. He considers it in some sense childish. You can hide beneath your covers. Who hides beneath their covers? It's a very childish image. You know, it's a very, like, as though if I don't, if it's not outside, if I can't see it, it's not really happening, or something like that. Make crosses from your, study your pain, some kind of introspective, suffering-related, I don't know what exactly. Make crosses from your lovers. I can't say exactly what that means, but it doesn't sound good. You know, it sounds like maybe turning them into Christ figures, or maybe something along those lines. Throw roses in the rain. That's a very Marian imagery. The rose is associated with Mary. I said that I would forswear biographical references, but I found this before the book came out. And when I did, I said, oh, that's beautiful. And I put in a footnote that Springsteen went to, the Catholic school he went to was the school of St. Rose of Lima. And the whole school is full of images of Mary and roses. But aside from that, the imagery, there are many miracles that are attributed to Mary that are shown by the appearance of a rose. So there's a way in which this woman, Mary, is also kind of related to the incorporeality of Mary, the virginity of Mary, the waste your summer. She's going to pray for a savior all summer long. But he says she's doing that in vain. So she represents a kind of otherworldly belief. He, on the other hand, is this worldly. And some of that is this worldly in just a physical, sexual sense. He says, don't run back inside, you know just what I'm here for. Well, you know, which is like he's speaking as an adult. He's wooing this woman. There's a sexual dimension to that, and it should be clear to both of us that that is part of what I'm doing. But then he says something, and he says, so you're scared, you're thinking that maybe we ain't that young anymore. Then he says something extraordinarily interesting, which is where I started to think that this was a much more complicated song than I had originally recognized. He says, show a little faith. Now, that, in a way, that's incongruous, because what do you mean, show a little faith? You just said she's praying all summer long. She's, you know, I mean, what do you want from her? But no, show a little faith. There's magic here in the night. In other words, it's not that he's saying, oh, reject that religious view, you know, that's all superstition or I don't know what dogma that we don't. He's saying exchange it for a different kind of faith, a faith in the here and now, a faith in the magic that can be between us. That theme is, again, is reiterated when he says to her, after he critiques her and says, waste your summer praying in vain for a savior to rise from the streets. Says, I'm no hero, that's understood. All the redemption I can offer girls beneath this dirty hood. Now here we have that moment that I referred to earlier where, on the one hand, you're bringing something down from the elevated religious text. On the other hand, you're elevating the here and now. All he can offer is this dirty hood, dirty. He uses the, you know, the it's not even a clean car. You know, that's how this worldly it is. It's a dirty hood. And yet, he calls it, it's going to be the vehicle of redemption. A different kind of redemption, obviously. We're not talking about salvation you know, in any kind of otherworldly sense. But this is the redemption that he wants to offer her. We've got one last chance to make it real, to trade in these wings on some wheels. Now, if you're weighing these two modes of transportation, wings versus wheels, one is far more glorious than the other. One is far more elevated than the other. One is far more salvific than the other, right? The wings, the angels, why would you trade them in on wheels? Why would you give up the promise of wings for the, you know, dirty, soot-covered wheels that he's offering her? Well, the answer he gives in the text is, we've got one last chance to make it real. You know, trading these wings on wheels, it's a huge downgrade. But it's real. It's real, here, you know, I am really here. And I'm offering you my love, my commitment, or, you know, whatever adventures we have, whatever it might be. And it's, and this is true, and I'm here, flesh and blood, you know, an option for you. Come take my hand. We're riding out tonight to case the promised land. It's a beautiful, beautiful phrase. What does it mean to case something, to case a joint? To case it out, to check it out, specifically because you're gonna have to break into it. You're gonna have to rob, you know, you case a joint to steal something from it, to break into it. Now what's so beautiful here is that you can see the tension between the otherworldly, the divine promise, and the traditionally understood, and how it's being reinterpreted here. Traditionally, the promised land doesn't need to be cased because it's promised. God will deliver it for you. Right? God will lead you into the promised land. It may not be...
But the spies did case it out.
The spies did case it out, but the whole problem with the spies was that they came back saying, you know, the native people there are too big and too powerful. In other words, they thought they really needed to break in and, you know, and they got scared.
Yeah.
They didn't realize that it was promised and that God would provide. You don't need to case out the promised land traditionally. But if the question is the here and now, we're going to have to make this work. We're going to have to do it ourselves. So it's the promised land, but you and I have to break in.
And that kind of imagery continues in Springsteen's earlier lyrics.
Yes, yes. The imagery of the promised land, not the promised land, which we're going to hear in a minute from Darkness on the Edge of Town, but the idea of the open road kind of leading to a redemption. You see that, you hear that very clearly in a song like Knife. You know, you hear it to some extent in a song like Born to Run, and you also have it in earlier songs, particularly in Greetings from Asbury Park, New Jersey, songs like Does This Bus Stop at 82nd Street, which is a kind of joyful, you know, it's a bus ride, and yet it turns into something almost magical. There are people flying throughout that song. Drink this and you'll grow wings on your feet. The Daily Post's found out, she rides to the heaven on a gyroscope, found out the dope, she rides to the heaven on a gyroscope. I mean, these people are having like heavenly ascents in the middle of the Bronx, pretty much. No, but you know, in a way in which that trip, and you know, it's a joyous trip because it's here and it's, you're living it. And that's very much part of some of these songs. And I want to emphasize, I'm not at all suggesting that, you know, all Springsteen songs are about this kind of stuff. But
then you say there's an abrupt change.
There's an abrupt change, yes. There's an abrupt change. There's an abrupt change, and there's an abrupt theological change. So Darkness on the Edge of Town basically breaks with that entire promise that is in Born to Run. I will mention one song that we're not going to discuss in detail, and then we'll listen to one song. The song that I'm going to mention without us listening to it is Racing in the Street. Racing in the Street is a song about a man who is basically living the dream of the Born to Run album. He's a racer. The song opens with a very detailed introduction to his car. 65 Chevy and her, you know, the specs of the car. me and my partner Sonny, we built it straight out of scratch, we drive it on the Northeast Strip. And he says some folks just give up living and start dying little by little, piece by piece. And some folks come home from work and they wash up, they go racing in the street. You know, he's saying this is authentic, this is true, this is redemptive. Mm. And he finds a woman this way. He basically wins this woman in a drag race. And everything should be perfect. If we were living in the world of Born to Run and the previous albums, this man would have attained redemption. The second half of the song is about the woman he's with is deeply depressed, stares out with the eyes of one who hates for just being born. I mean, it's a terrible, terrible image of what this kind of depression is. And the only theological element, explicit theological element, is at the very end, where it says, tonight, my baby, the last line is, tonight, my baby and me, we're going to drive to the sea to wash these sins off our hands. You say, what sins are you talking about? He had it in the song, they don't say that anyone cheated on anyone or anyone stole anything or anyone. But presumably, the virtues of Born to Run are now recognized as sins. You know, that you don't sing a song in which you give a detailed description of your car, but you don't tell us the name of the woman that you love. You don't sing a song about how you beat a guy from LA driving a Camaro, and that's how you got your girl, and that's all we know. You know, that he won her in this race. And that's a kind of very reflective reckoning, self-reflective reckoning that Springsteen is doing about his own work and about what kind of theological promise he had made in the earlier album, and he's rethinking that and basically denying it in a very powerful way.
I know we're not doing biography, but in the early chapters of his autobiography, he writes very movingly of envying his friend, whose father took him to the race together.
Right.
And as you say, driving to the shore, he said the one thing his father liked to do was to drive down to the shore and just gaze out.
Yeah.
It's poignant to hear these echoes. Let's listen now to this song, which is?
The Promised Land.
The Promised Land.
So I believe that's the third song on the list, on your on the handout. Thank you.
This time, rather than driving into a hopeful future, he's driving into the storm.
Right, right. So the song is a critique of this earlier image that he had projected. In. So first of all, we see starting off, it takes place in the desert, which means he's not in the promised land. It's remarkable that it's in the Utah desert. It's not where Springsteen locates most of his songs, but a song is called The Promised Land, and he's telling you I'm still in the desert. He clearly hasn't made it there yet. Working all day in my daddy's garage, driving all night chasing some mirage. Right there you see, what is the drive here? It's not what it was in a song like Night. A song like Night, the nighttime drive is redemption. You know, and you're alive, and every muscle in your body sings. And so here, driving all night, chasing some mirage, he's not getting anywhere. Pretty soon, girl, I'm going to take charge. Yeah, but so you haven't. You know, I mean, you're saying you will. You're hoping you will. Even, you know, the dogs on Main Street howl because they understand, if I could take one moment. You know, there's this sense of impotence, of lack of agency. If only I could make this happen, if only I could make this true and, you know, be who I want to be and do what I want to do and live the life I want to live, but it's not. And he says, it's almost apologetic. I've done my best to live the right way. You know, I'm trying. I get up every morning, I go to work each, but it's not enough. Yeah. You know, because this violence wells up within him. I mean, really very terrible graphic imagery here. Your eyes go blind, your blood runs cold, I feel so, take a knife and cut this pain from my heart. Explode and tear this whole town apart. Take a knife and cut this pain from my heart. I mean, if we read this in any literal sense, and I'm not saying that we should, but the imagery is one of a kind of murder and a suicide. You know, explode and tear the town apart, and then cut the pain from my own heart. It's very troubling, and this man, despite doing what he should be doing and working, and he's getting nowhere. And then we shift gears theologically to, rather than having a religious or theological image of a road leading to the promised land, we have the imagery of the apocalypse, which in traditional understanding, one of the ways that we distinguish the apocalypse, apocalyptic thought from prophetic thought, is because of its lack of agency. The apocalypse just happens. You don't bring it about, you don't make it happen. It's just going to happen. And here, this cloud rises up from the desert floor. It's the reversal of the cloud that led the children of Israel into the promised land. In the book of Exodus, the children of Israel follow a cloud by day into the promised land. Here, the cloud rises in the desert and it's destructive. It's not leading anyone to the promised land. He gets into the car, and it's almost a suicidal act in the end. He drives straight into the storm. It maybe isn't fully suicidal, maybe that's an overstatement, but it does echo the drive into the storm from readings from Asbury Park, New Jersey, from the song Lost in the Flood, where one of the characters just drives into the storm and dies. Basically, it's like splattered on the highway. So the album is much darker. All these things are different, but theologically too. In other words, he puts this in theological terms. No access to the promised land, instead an apocalyptic storm that's going to come and tear everything down.
So what he's doing, consciously or not, right, but with your interpretation, is he's showing in a virtuoso way the range of religious language and imagery that can be both hopeful and promise,
right,
and desperate and destructive and terminal.
Well, that's why I called it Bruce Springsteen's Theologies.
Jeez, yes.
In plural. You know, because what I found in writing, you know, in working on the different lyrics, is that there are dramatic changes from album to album and, you know, from songs in across his production. I don't want to try and force it into such a narrow definition, say, you know, Springsteen has a theology. This is completely different than wash these sins off our hands at the end of Racing in the Street. You know, those are very different theological motifs than the earlier ones. So yes, he's showing that range, and even you could say adopting different theologies.
Shortly, we're going to open this conversation up to the experts in the audience with your own deep knowledge of Springsteen's lyrics and these religious motifs in many different registers throughout his life and work. But we're going to close this part of our conversation, Azzan, with what Professor Yadin-Israel is expert on, Midrash. You've got this extraordinary section at the end where you look at the way in which Springsteen himself handles biblical texts and stories.
Right.
And we're going to focus on one of them, a Christian story, and we're going to listen to that song.
Arguably the Christian story.
Yes, Christian.
The Passion narrative. Yeah. Yeah, so this is Jesus Was an Only Son, which is the first song on the handout. And yes, it's a retelling of the Passion narrative and much more.
When Jesus was an only son, as he walked to Calvary Hill, Mother Mary walking beside him in the path with his blood spilled.
In Midrash, you say, in the book, the rabbis took a difficult text where the meaning is not often obvious or might seem contradictory or the text seems incomplete,
right,
and they offer different readings of how it might make sense.
Yeah.
So do you see Springsteen doing Midrash with these kinds of stories?
I mean, I don't see him doing...
Or you're doing Midrash with his
book. Well, maybe it's both. Maybe it's a chain of Midrash. But I think that, at least in my interpretation, I'm trying to be as transparent as possible. So I'm saying, here's what I think he's doing, and here's how I'm reading it, and here's why I'm doing it. So at the very least, I'm letting people judge as easily, as accessibly as possible, what I'm saying, and you know whether it makes sense to them. I think what he's doing here, so Midrash can be a kind of philological work where you're trying to make sense of texts. It can also be that in the course of interpreting the text, you reveal new insights and new dimensions that maybe weren't immediately apparent. And that, I would say, he's very much doing. So in this song, the title, Jesus Was an Only Son, is almost a religious cliche. You know, in the Gospel of John, in John 3:16, for he so loved the world, gave his one and only son. So, you know, Jesus's status as an only son is not problematic, it's self-evident, and it's like, okay, great. So what's the song about? Well, Jesus was an only son. As he walked up Calvary Hill, his mother Mary walking beside him in the path where his blood spilled. Jesus was an only son. In the hills of Nazareth, as he lay reading the Psalms of David at his mother's feet. So the opening stanza tells us that Springsteen is already undertaking a very radical and interesting rereading, because the song's about Jesus was an only son, but not about his sonship of God. It's about Jesus being the only son of Mary. And that's the perspective that the song takes from this point, which is, yes, theologically, in terms of, if we think of the figure of Jesus as standing in tension between the divine and the human. So if we, on the divine side, the story of the Passion is a glorious culmination of Jesus's ascent to heaven. And he dies in order to overcome death, to be resurrected, and to take his place at the right hand of glory. So that's a positive and uplifting story. And Springsteen says, yes, but he was also the only son of Mary. And she's actually the one who is present. She's the one who's standing beside him during the Passion at the time of his death. And she was the one who was with him when he was a young man. You know, this is a very beautiful domestic scene. The son is lying, you know, at his mother's feet, reading the Psalms of David. So, you know, right there he takes a line like Jesus was the only son, the only son of God, and reverses it in a very insightful way. Now the second stanza is really heartbreaking. A mother prays, sleep tight, my child, etc. You know, this is just generally mothers. Mothers pray for the well-being of their son, of their children, but here it's my child, of their children. That no shadow shall pierce your dreams this night. Okay. So Mary is also a mother, and presumably like all mothers, she prays for the well-being of her son. Except that Mary's case is different. Because all the other mothers pray to God for the well-being of their sons. Mary's praying to God for the well-being of his son. In other words, if there was any mother whose prayer should be answered, it would be Mary's. And yet, because of the way Springsteen structured the song, we already know that that prayer is not going to be answered. Because it starts out with Jesus, with Mary walking in the path where his blood spilled. And notice, and this is why I say you should read this as a poem, she says, I'll be by your side. I'll be by your side. That's the prayer. But we know from the first paragraph, how is she going to be by his side? She's going to be by his side as he's dying. In other words, not only is her prayer not going to be answered, it's going to be rebuffed in the most horrible way.
That's very moving, both opening up the song for us, but the profound insights of Springsteen himself. Now is the opportunity for your profound insights. My wife and I once went to a beautiful 18th century synagogue in Carpentras in the south of France,
where there was a chair, an empty chair halfway up the wall by a window, and it's waiting for the prophet Elijah to come back. We're waiting for Bruce to walk in. So I'm leaving this chair empty now. And I think we would all agree that you've already filled it with an extraordinary understanding of Bruce Springsteen's theological lyrics and religious understanding. Thank you very much.